I'll say some other things about background as well. So, I'm Kate Devlin. For 12 years I was in the computing department here at Goldsmiths. I'm now at King's, where I work in the digital humanities department. And I'm a senior lecturer there in social and cultural AI. So I look at how AI impacts on society and how we respond to it and what will happen in the future. That's the bit I don't like predicting. No one likes doing predictions unless they're very long term, so you can't get caught out. Okay, so this is the sign that's up in the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation in Seattle. When you go in, it's the first thing you see on the wall. You see, we are impatient optimists. And when I saw that, I was like, oh yeah, that describes me quite well, because I would call myself a tech optimist. I think that technology can be of huge benefit to people. I think that the technology we have, even though we've seen some really awful uses of it, I think that the overall we win out in terms of how our lives have improved. But I do have concerns like that, and I want to call for a better use of AI. This is a tweet from a friend of mine, Rob McCargo, a couple of weeks ago on Twitter. He posted a picture from the World Economic Forum that said that AI has the potential to enrich our lives in so many ways if we use it properly. And as Rob points out, I used to say stuff like this until someone smarter than me asked me to define we. Because it is a particularly technocratic and privileged position to be in, to talk about AI, to do AI, and to benefit from it. As Dan mentioned, and Stuart mentioned as well, we know there's lots of different types of algorithmic bias in AI. And everyone's aware of it, been aware of it for quite a few years now. No one has a solution yet. It's very, very difficult to fix. And I was at Broads on AI on Thursday, and in one of the panels there was a guy speaking. He was a machine learning engineer. And he said, oh, it's not a problem though. We have laws against that kind of thing. And I thought, that's a very engineering sort of approach to this. Sure, we do have laws. So, the laws will catch everything, and we're amplifying bias. So we have bias in the data that we collect. So for example, I'm wearing a fitness tracker. All that data from the fitness tracker gets fed back to the company who makes it. Now they're doing really cool stuff with that. They're taking that data, which I'm quite freely giving them because I want to use their services. And they've taken the data and they amalgamated it and they've done scans and they've done medical research on that data. Well, that's brilliant. They're making medical advances through the use of our data. They're making medical advances on the people who work, and the data for people who own Fitbit, who can afford to buy one. It's a very, very select community. And so we are excluding people from tech, and that's not just a bias in terms of sex or race, it's also in class as well. We have interaction bias where if we use something like an information retrieval chatbot, we're feeding in information, the bot is learning from the information we give it, and we wind up with things like Microsoft Tag, which was a bot that was released on Twitter. It took 16 hours for it to come out with fascist and sexist statements. I think it was even retweeting dick pics at one point. So we have this kind of garbage in, garbage out phenomenon that we know about, but we're deliberately influencing that way. We have things like similarity bias, where we kind of reinforce the views we already have and entrench us in our own views, which is why it's a surprise that all of a sudden we're facing Brexit. All along we're going, of course everyone wants to be in Europe, why wouldn't we? We have things like self-reinforcing bias, which, you know, if you search on Google for a picture of a physicist and you get a guy in a lab coat with white hair and you choose that for your slides, then suddenly, you know, Google's saying that that's what people are looking for when they're looking for physicists. Now they're kind of wise to this now, and they try to fix it. But overall, although we have this technology and we're aware that we're biased, because humans themselves are biased, we all carry biases within us, we have to try and mitigate, and it's very, very hard to mitigate. We don't really have a good solution for verifying that we are truly being unbiased. And even when we try, so when Amazon brought in software to try and take away bias from the interview process, they found out they were still being biased because the language being used was gendered, and they were basing it on previous data sets that they had. To focus briefly on sexism in AI, it goes outside the bias as well, because we have 12% of leading machine learning researchers are women. That was taken from an analysis of papers that were submitted to conferences in the field. And globally, 22% of AI professionals are female. So we have a massive gender gap there. So we know this, we've seen lots of articles around last year, especially the Invisible Women book being released, currently by the Press book, that the default user is always assumed to be white and male. So we are building technology, and I say we again, that's the real. Silicon Valley, particularly, is building technology where the assumption is that the user is going to be like the person developing. The user is going to be that white male. And you see it in things like Apple releasing a health tracker that didn't align a tracking of menstruation. So you couldn't track a period from that health tracker. So 21% of the population who may or may not be menstruating couldn't actually track it. Normally I talk about sex robots because that was my area of research for a few years. I'm not going to do that today because quite frankly I'm sick of talking about it. I just wanted to bring up this. If you think that sex robots can murder you, they can't. I'm planning to by men. This is not just a men fashion talk, I'm not going to just we get a rate up of the strangest things, you know, so this is a massive hype around sex robots, none of which has come to pass. I think it's good to say it's staying very, very niche area, but it's fascinating in terms of what it tells us about us. And it's fascinating in terms of how we approach things like that. And, but you know, we have so many worries around AI, we're not really worried in the right places. You know, we get these fears about superintelligence. We've got robot vacuum cleaners that eat themselves on rocks. So you know, I think we're worried about the wrong things. The voice assistants we have in our homes, all of them started off as female voices. And like Dan was saying, you know, we're seeing these biases here, and that the very attitude is that you have a subservient machine that is voiced female. And it was not necessarily a deliberate choice, though I suspect it may have just a little bit been. But this underlying assumption that comes on from a role, from the effective labour role, from the emotional labour performing customer service that's been going on for years, so female telephone operators or secretaries. And it feeds on from that where the assumption is that it is particular gender that is dealing with that effective labour and that emotional labour. As I mentioned, you know, a lot of AI contains the human element. So this XKCD cartoon, you know, to complete your registration, please tell us whether or not this image contains a stop sign. Answer quickly, our self-driving cars almost at the intersection. So every time you do a captcha on Google, for example, and you're asked to identify the traffic lights, that's training a data set that can be used in a self-driving car. This is offloading data onto us, but it's also done in a monetized way. So, Dan referred to this directly. There are companies that are paying people in slums in Nairobi, particularly women, paying women, to go out to be trained up to sit in a very boring environment all day and just taking little images. And I find this interesting. I teach a module on gender and technology, just in case you can't tell. So this is an article from BBC, and the woman who is in HR for this company said, like a lot of people say, if you have a man in the workplace, he can support his family, his talent, father, and his human resources. But if you have a woman in the workplace, she can support her family and the extended family, so you'll have a lot more impact. So again, there's this idea that women are contributing more at home as well. Now, the company doing this, the article spin on this, tends to be, look at the Silicon Valley company, they're doing really good things in the slums of Nairobi, instead of saying, look at the Silicon Valley company, they're exploiting poor people in a different country. And then they said, you know, well, we couldn't pay the same as we pay in Silicon Valley because that would disrupt the local economy and they wouldn't know what to do with all that money. And you think, listen to yourselves, you know? You might not be able to do that, but what else are you investing? I'm not convinced, I don't know if that's actually the truth in that. But, you know, can you invest in other ways? What's going on here? It sounds suspiciously like you're offloading things to another community. So, this is a bit where key, and say, can we move towards a new form of AI? And so not, you know, the AI itself is not the problem, although, you know, technology is not neutral, but the AI itself, we can use in different ways. So who is shaping the technology? Who's benefiting from the technology? And who's threatened by it? And I think we need to analyze and ask that of all the technology we encounter. And I have some concerns we're going to see a wave of genetic scandals in the next few years, centered on the fact that data has been given uncritically in a lot of cases and paid for by by lots of great sources. We've just seen the absolute problem with funding at MIT. We know that Saudi Arabia has been funding animal health, for example, which is another company where I think there's room to come out. So I think there are problems that we will see a kickback, and we will see exposés starting to be really concerned. So my plea is to move towards human-centered AI, and it makes that discipline of human-computer interaction with AI. And I've been working on human-computer interaction stuff for years, and I find it really interesting to watch the progress in software engineering. We went from this kind of interface, or we went from the command line, to this kind of checkbox interface. And more and more over time, it became a thing about user experience. So we saw this increase in how can we make things better for you, the user? How can we make this suited to people fit into their lives? And I think that there is a call for that. It may be that while we do that, we can see ways of making things more sustainable and transparent. Not that that's necessarily the best way to come about things. So that's my call, is that we will start to put users in the center, we will consider user journeys, we will consider test cases and user cases. So I want to end with the thought that why are we doing this? Why are we doing this? Why are we picking up pieces of technology? And like Stuart said, the things we can do are really incredible. Do we have to then automate everything? Is it always going to be necessary to put AI into alongside it? So, Stuart mentioned the AI winters. We've had a couple already. So we had the AI winter when with language translation didn't really take off all that well, and funding started decreasing, and there was a kind of a bubble of machine learning all the time. Then we saw the resurgence in the 80s, and then that didn't really go anywhere. And now we're at the height of this bubble, I think, and we're starting to see that we're not going to make any more drastic leaps forward for the next while, although I'm quite happy to be told that's not true. So I think, you know, if we do see another crash, one of the interesting things about AI winters and crashes is that they tend to change the direction of AI. They tend to take it into new territory. So we look for alternatives to do things. And I hope that if we do have another AI winter, that AI winter then starts to look at a more humanitarian-centered approach, starts to put people more at the center of it. And I'm hopeful that people are recognizing now the need to keep humans in the loop, is I suppose the term to use, but choose the world before how they control the machine. But I think keeping humans at the centre of this, and I hope that becomes a thing in the future. And I think given the increase in concern around AI ethics and the way the AI ethics community has grown so massively in the past few years, that the intention is there. We don't have those practical steps. We don't really know how to deliver all those guidelines, and there are many guidelines that have been set up. So yeah, so in summary, you know, I still think I'm a tech optimist. I still think we can do good things. There are things that terrify me, deep fakes, for example. The fact that we are questioning the very reality of what we can show. It's something we should always do, but it's becoming harder and harder to differentiate. So I think there are problems, I think there are things that scare me. Superintelligence is not one of those things. But we need to think really carefully about the difference.